Hello everyone, this is Dr. Ashish Vanmai and welcome to the video lecture on how to solve the problems of morphological image processing. This is part 1 of the video series, and in this video we will see the problems on the basic operations like dilation, erosion, opening and closing. So let's look at the first question. The question is, for the image and the structuring element shown below, perform the operation of dilation, erosion, opening and closing. And there is an image and the structuring element provided over here. So let's go for the first part, that is a dilation. The dilation of image A by structuring element B is given by set of all Z such that B cap Z intersection with A is not a null set. So practically speaking, it is nothing but set of all displacement Z such that B cap and A overlap at least by one point. And here the B cap is nothing but the reflected version of structuring element B. The process of dilation can be carried out in four steps. In step one, we find B cap, that is the reflected version of B. In step two, we pad image A with zeros to get A pad. In fact, one can even skip this step. However, we will keep this step to keep consistency with the approach that we have learned in spatial domain filtering. In step 3, we will keep the center of B cap at different locations of A pad, and we will identify the underlying subimage. And when we do this process, we will always ensure that we keep the center inside A only. That means we don't go outside the original image. And then in step 4, we check if there is any overlap between A and B cap. If there is any overlap, then the corresponding output will be 1, else the output will be 0. So let's start with the first step, that is to find the reflected version of B, that is B cap. So we can see the structuring element B over here. Now if you observe carefully, then in this particular case it is not an odd size structuring element. Okay, however, in this case they have marked the center with the circle over here. So we know where the exact center of the structuring element is. So for ease of understanding, I have drawn the x and y axis on the structuring element, where the origin will coincide with the center of the structuring element. The vertical axis will be the x-axis and the horizontal axis will be the y-axis with the direction shown. To find B cap, we will have to fold or reflect the structuring element B along both these axes. That means we can first fold it along y-axis and then we can fold it along x-axis, or we can do it reverse. That means first fold it along the x-axis and then fold it along y-axis. Let me first fold it along y-axis. If we fold it along y-axis, then the result is as shown in the figure 2 over here. Now we need to fold this result along x-axis to get the result B cap. So this is how the original structuring element B and its reflected version B cap will look like. The second step is to pair the image A with zeros. So we will take the reflected version of B, that is B cap, and depending on where its center is and how many pixels it has on the top, bottom, left and right, accordingly we are going to pad our image A. This process is similar to what we have done in spatial domain filtering. Now if we consider this structuring element as a mask, then the center of the structuring element is nothing but the center of the mask. And to keep the size of the output image same, what we are going to do is we are going to keep the center always inside the image. However, when we do this, it may happen that some part of the mask may go outside the image. In such condition, when we find the underneath sub-image, we need to pair the original image with the values. And that is how we are doing same over here also. Consider that B cap has x top number of pixels above its center and it has x bottom number of pixels below its center. Similarly, consider that it has y left number of pixels on left side of its center and y right number of pixels on the right side of its center. Hence, when we pad A with zeros, we are going to pad it with x top number of rows on the top side, x bottom number of rows on the bottom side, y left number of columns on the left side, and y right number of columns on the right side with zeros. Now coming back to our problem, we have image A of size 8 cross 8 and the structuring element B was of size 2 cross 2 and we found its reflective version B cap. Now when you see this B cap, you can observe that if you see the center, then above the center there is one row and on the left side there is one column. There is no row below the center of B cap and there is no column on the right side of the center of the B cap. That means when we pad A, then we are going to pad one row above it with the zeros and one column left of it. We will not be padding anything on the bottom or the right of A. The resultant A pad is shown over here in the third figure. Now for the simplicity of understanding, we are showing two boundaries over here, one with the blue line, and that blue line boundary is corresponding to the original image, and the orange boundary corresponds to the image that what we obtained after padding the A with corresponding number of zeros. Now we will perform step number 3 and step number 4 together. The step number 3 is to keep the center of B cap at different locations of A pad. And we need to identify the underlying sub-image from A pad. Now when we do this process, we will always ensure that the center of B cap will always lie inside the original image A. That means over here the center will always lie inside the blue boundary. The step number 4 is to check if there is any overlap between the values of A and B cap. If there is an overlap, then the corresponding output will be 1, else the output will be 0. Now to check this overlap, what we are going to do is we are going to compare the sub-image that we have extracted from A pad and B cap. We will say that the values of A and B cap overlap each other if we have at least one 1 corresponding to the locations of 1s of B cap in the sub-image. So if we get at least one 1, then there is a overlap. If there is no such 1 present corresponding to the locations of 1 of B cap, then we say that there is no overlap between A and B cap. Now see the example over here where we have kept the center of B cap on the first pixel of A. So in the first image, that locations are shown with a red boundary and the center location is shown with red circle. So in the third image over here, the corresponding underlying sub-image is shown and the second image shows the corresponding B cap. Now what we are going to do is compare the locations of 1 of B cap. So there are 3 ones in B cap. So we are going to check the corresponding locations of sub-image. If we get any of these locations with value 1, we will say that we have a overlap and the output will be 1. If there is no such ones present, then the output will be 0. In fact, in this particular case, we can see that all the sub-image values are 0. Hence, there is no overlap between B cap and the image. Hence, the output will be 0. The location of the output is where we have kept the center of the sub-image. Okay, so we have kept the center of the sub-image, we have kept the center of the B cap at the first row and the first column of the A. So that will be my corresponding output location, okay, of the output image. And always remember that my size of the output image will be same as the size of A. Now we move the B cap to the next location. So my center of B cap is now at the first row, second column of my image A, and the corresponding overlapping area of A pad is shown with the red circle again. red rectangle square over here. Now the corresponding sub-image over here is again all zeros. Hence, if we check the overlap, then there is no overlap between B cap and sub-image. Hence, my corresponding output will be also zero, which is shown in the fourth figure. Now we can proceed like this and find out the output for different locations. Now, in fact, if you see over here, then in all the cases when we keep the center in the first row of A, we always get the corresponding sub-image to be all zeros. Hence, corresponding all the outputs are zeros. So thus we have completed the first row over here. We will start now with the second row, first column. So the location of the sub-image is shown with the red square again, and the corresponding center location. And the extracted sub-image in this case again is zero. Hence, the output is also zero, which is shown in the fourth figure. Now, when we move the center to the second row, second column of A, which is shown with the red square again in A pad, we can see the corresponding sub-image over there. Okay, so the first row of the sub-image is 0, 0 and the second row is 0, 1. So there is a 1 corresponding to the center location. That means there is an overlap between the A and B cap now. So hence for this particular center location, my output will be 1, which is shown in the fourth image. Similarly, we can move our center to the next pixel. Now in this case, when you extract the sub-image, you will find that the first row is 0, 0 and the second row is 1, 1. That means there are two 1s overlapping between B cap and the image. Hence, the output is again 1. So like this, we can proceed. So wherever we find that there is overlapping of 1s, we will have the corresponding output as 1. And if there is no overlap between the 1s of B cap and the corresponding sub-image, the corresponding output will be 0. And like this, we can proceed and complete the entire result. So this is how the final output image will look like. So this is the output of a dilation. Let us compare the original image and the output image. So the first image shows the original image A, and the second image shows the corresponding output image after the process of dilation. The object or the ones are marked with the blue background in the original image, and the corresponding locations are also marked with the blue background in the output image. The new ones, which are created by the process of dilation, are marked with the orange background over here. So if you observe carefully, we can see that in the output image, the original object has grown in size. So how much is the growth, or in what direction my object is growing? To understand this, consider the structuring element. Okay, so we are considering the original structuring element, not B cap. So over here, the first figure shows the original image, the second figure shows the structuring element B, and the third image shows the output. Now if you observe the structuring element carefully over here, then in that structuring element you can observe that whatever the center value is 1, and also the ones are there, okay, one below the center of structuring element and one on the right of the structuring element. Now since the center is 1, it is always going to preserve the original elements of the object. Since it has one row below the center in the structuring element as 1, that means there is one below the structuring element, it is going to grow one row below the object. Similarly, there is one column on the right of the center of the structuring element, which is 1. Hence, it is going to grow by one column on the right of the original object. So if you see the growth, you can always find in this particular case that whatever the original object is preserved as it is, and there is a one row growth below it, and there is one column growth on right of it. Now let's move to the part B, that is erosion. The erosion of image A by structuring element B is z of all z such that bz contained in A. So over here what we are saying that whenever we displace the B, okay, so remember in this case we are using B, not B cap. Okay, so whenever we move the structuring element B, it should be totally contained in A. Okay, the meaning of totally contained in A means wherever you have ones in B, okay, at those locations A should also have ones. Okay, if it happens that way, then we say it is totally contained. If not, then it is not totally contained, hence the result will be zero. The process of erosion can be carried out in three steps. In the step one, we will pad image A with zeros. Now here the padding will depend on B and not B cap. In the second step, we will keep the center of B at different pixel locations of A pad, and we will identify the underlying subimage. And in step three, we will check whether a B is totally contained in A or not, looking at the subimage. If B is totally contained, then the corresponding output will be 1, else the output will be 0. So let's start with the first step, that is to pad image A with zeros. So we will take the structuring element B over here, and we will consider that x top is the number of pixels above the center of B, and x bottom are the number of pixels below the center of B. Similarly, we will have y left number of pixels on left of the center of B, and y right will be the number of pixels on the right hand side of the center of B. Hence, we will pad x top number of rows on the top of A, and we will pad x bottom number of rows at the bottom of A. Similarly, we will pad y left number of columns on the left side of A, and y right number of columns on the right side of A. Again, while padding, we are going to use the value as 0. For this problem, we have the structuring element B, which is shown over here in the second image. So this structuring element has one row below the center and one column on the right of the center. So when we pad, we are going to pad one row below A and one column on right of A, and we are going to pad it with zeros. So we can see A, that is the original image, and you can also see the A pad, that is the image after padding zeros. Again, in this case, we use the blue boundary and orange boundary as a reference. So blue boundary is the boundary of A, or you can say outline of A, and A pad is the outline of A pad. Now we will perform the step number 2 and step number 3 together. In step number 2, we keep the center of B on different pixel locations of A pad and identify the underlying subimage. Now while doing this, we will always ensure that the center of B is always inside A. That means for this case, it will always lie inside the blue boundary. And in step number 3, we check whether B is totally contained in A or not. If B is totally contained in A, then the corresponding output will be 0, else the corresponding output will be 1. Now here, as I said again earlier, that we will say that B is totally contained in A only if the corresponding underlying subimage has ones corresponding all the locations of ones of B. So wherever you have ones in B, at the same location if there are ones in the subimage, then I will say B is totally contained and the output will be 1. If you don't have any one of B underlying one in subimage, then the output will be 0. So in this case, we have kept the center at the first location of A. You can see the corresponding subimage, and the subimage is 0, 0, 0, 1. So you can clearly see that there are 3 ones in B and none of them has ones underlying them. So automatically my output will be 0. And this will come at the first location of the output image. Now when we move our center to the next pixel, the corresponding subimage has the values 0, 0, 1, 1. So in this case, we can see that there is one of B overlapping with a 1 in the subimage. But that is not what we require. We require that all the ones of B should have underlying ones in the subimage. So in this case, there is an overlap, but B is not totally contained. Okay, since it is not totally contained, the corresponding output will be again 0 in this case. So if you proceed like this, we can find the output for different locations. Now here, for the first row, you can see that every time we will get the output as 0, because B will never be totally contained by the subimage or A. Now let's move to the second row. So we have kept our center on the first pixel of the second row, and the corresponding subimage is also shown. Again, we can see that the subimage doesn't have all the ones corresponding to location of ones of B. Hence, B is not contained, and we can say the output is again 0 over here. If we move to the next pixel, then we will find that the underlying subimage in this case is now 1, 1, 1, 1. And now if you compare, you will find that there are ones at all the locations of ones of B. Hence, in this particular case, we will see that, say that my B is totally contained, and hence my output will be 1 over here. So we can continue this process and keep on moving our structuring element B and keep the center of B at different pixel locations. Again, ensure that the center is kept inside the locations of A only. That means the center is inside the blue boundary, and we will check every time whether the subimage has all the ones or not corresponding to B, and if it is, then we will say that it is totally contained and the output will be 1. Otherwise, the output will be 0. So if we proceed like this, we can get the corresponding output image, which is shown over here. So here you can see the comparison of the original image A and the corresponding output of the erosion. So if you observe carefully, you will find that the object in image A has now shrunk. So how much the object has shrunk? Let's try to understand that. Now to understand this, we need to look at the structuring element B. So in B, if you observe carefully, you will find that the center pixel of structuring element B has a value 1. And also there is 1, 1 below the center, and there is 1, 1 on the right of the center. That means this particular structuring element is going to shrink the image from below and from right, and that it is going to do it by 1 pixel. Okay, now since there is 1 pixel below my center, so it is going to shrink my image below, or my shrink my object below, and there is 1 pixel on the right of the center with the value 1, so it is going to shrink my object from the right side by amount of 1. So now if you compare the input image A and the corresponding output of erosion, you can clearly understand, yes, it has shrunk it below and on the right side. Now let's go for the part C, that is opening, and then we will have the part D, that is closing. Now both these opening and closing, they are the kind of a recursive applications of erosion and dilation. So in this case, if you understood the operation of erosion and dilation properly, one can easily do the operation of opening and closing. So let's first go for opening. The opening of A by structuring element B is given as first erode A with B, and then whatever the result, you have to dilate that result with B again. So it is a simple two-step process where we first perform the erosion operation, and on the result we perform the dilation operation. We have already performed the operation of erosion in part B. So let's take that result directly. So you can see the input image A, the structuring element B, and the corresponding output that we obtained after eroding A with B. Now this result of A erosion with B, we have to dilate with B. So for that, you will require the B cap. So you can see the B cap also shown over here, which is the reflected version of B. And now we need to perform the operation of dilation. Okay, so we are going to dilate A erode B result with B-cap. Remember that we are always going to use B-cap in the process of dilation. And we are going to check if there is any overlap between the values of B-cap and the image that we are dilating. That means in this case, we are going to check whether there is any overlap between the values of A dot B and the values of B-cap. If there is any overlap, then the corresponding output will be 1. And if no overlap, then the corresponding output will be 0. Okay, so like the previous example, means like the previous case, that is part A, you can apply the entire process and you can find the output. And that will give us the output of the opening, which is shown over here in the last figure. Now let's go for the last part of this problem, that is closing, which is kind of opposite of opening. So in this case, what we are going to do is we are going to first dilate A with B, and whatever the result that we have, then we are going to erode it with B. So it will be a dilation operation first and then erosion operation. So it is kind of opposite of opening. In the opening, we have first erosion and then dilation, whereas in this closing, we have first dilation and then erosion. So here we are again taking the result from part A. So we have dilated A with structuring element B. That means we have checked for the overlap of B cap with A. And if there is overlap, the corresponding outputs are 1. And if there is no overlap, then the corresponding outputs are 0. Now whatever result we have obtained after dilation, that result we are going to erode with B. So in this case, we are going to check whether B is totally contained by that result of dilation or not. If it is totally contained, then the corresponding result will be 1. If B is not totally contained, then the corresponding result will be 0. So in the last figure, you can see the corresponding output of closing. So I hope that everyone has now understood how we perform the operation of dilation, erosion, opening and closing. Actually, these operations form the basis of any morphological process. So one has to understand them very carefully. And then for any application or problem in hand, we just need to apply them as per the algorithm. Now let's go for the second question. The question over here is, perform the operation of opening and closing for the following image. Use the structuring element shown, and they have given the image and a structuring element. Now if you again observe the structuring element over here, then it is not a square one, but actually the structuring element is of odd size. It has one rows and three columns over there. Hence, this particular structuring element is actually symmetric. That means when you find the reflected version of this structuring element, you will find that it is same as the original structuring element. So let's perform the first part, that is the opening operation. Similar to the previous problem, the opening operation will be performed in two steps. In the step one, we will erode A by structuring element B. And then whatever the result of erosion, we will dilate that result with structuring element B. Now in this case, I will show the quick results that we will get. So let's first find the A pad. Now, as I said earlier, in this particular case, B will be symmetric. So A pad, what you get after considering the padding with respect to B or B cap will be same. So over here, A is a 5x5 image and B is a 1x3 structuring element. So when we observe B, then the center, there is no row above or below it. So there is no padding of rows above and below for A. There is one column on left and one column on right of B. Hence, we will be padding one column on the left and one column on the right of A. We will now erode A with B. Now, if you observe the A, then A actually has 1 pixel diagonal line over there, whereas B is a 3 pixel wide structuring element. Hence, it will never be contained in A. Hence, the result of erosion in this case will be all zeros, and that is what you can observe over here. In the second step, we are going to dilate the result obtained after the erosion. That means whatever A erode B result we have, we are going to dilate it with B again. Now in this particular case, we are going to use the B cap and we are going to check for the overlap. Hence when we pad, we are going to pad the zeros with respect to the B cap. So as I said again, the B is same as B cap. Hence we are going to pad one column on the left and right of whatever image we want to pad. There will not be any padding at the top and bottom. So we can see the padded image with the zeros over here. And then to complete the dilation operation, we are going to check whether there is any overlap between the whatever result we have with respect to B cap. However, in this particular case, the operation of erosion has resulted in all zero values. Hence, there will not be any overlap that is possible with B cap. Hence, the operation or the output of the operation of opening will be again all zero values. After opening, let's go for the second part of the question, that is closing. The operation of closing will be a two-step process. In the first step, we are going to dilate A with B, and then whatever result we have, we are going to erode it with B again. For the operation of dilation, we are going to check whether there is any overlap between the values of A and B cap. For that, we will pad the A with respect to B cap, which is shown over here. Then we are going to keep the B cap at different locations and then we are going to check whether there is any overlap. If there is overlap, the corresponding output will be 1, otherwise the output will be 0. And while doing this, we are always going to ensure that the center of B cap lies inside A. Accordingly, the result of the dilation is shown over here. I advise students to please work upon it. Okay, do all the steps one by one and see or check whether you get the similar result or not. So whatever the result of dilation, we are going to then erode with B. So for that, we will first pad the result of dilation. So again, in this particular case, since it's an erosion operation, the padding will be with respect to B. So we'll pad one column on left and right of whatever result of dilation. And after that, we will check whether B is totally contained by the sub-image or not. So for that, we will again keep B at different locations. Again, we will ensure that the center of B is inside the A only, and we check whether we have all ones in the sub-image corresponding to the ones that are present in B, and corresponding result will be the result of closing. So you can see the last figure where you can see the final output of closing operation. Now if you observe carefully over here, you can see that initially A had ones along the diagonal. In this result also we have ones along the diagonal. Only thing is the first element and the last element of the diagonal has now been eliminated. So that is how the closing has eliminated the top and the bottom diagonal element. So this brings us to the end of the part 1 of the video series on how to solve the problems of morphological image processing. Now we have seen the basic operations of dilation, erosion, opening and closing. Now as I said earlier also, these are the basic foundation operations. So one has to practice them and get a grip on them. Once you have a grip on these four operations, then you can solve any other problem very easily. So thank you for the timing. And if you have any doubts, please write it back to me on my email ID, that is ivpashish@gmail.com.